Cell phones. Everybody, turn off your cell phone right now. Ren, wave your hand. Ren, over here sitting next to Stephanie, has the box. The red box of shame. If your phone goes off, she's going to bring it to you to make a donation. We prefer a dollar per ring. And at this time, if you will all stand, Charlie Meadows is going to lead us in prayer. And then immediately after that, Paul Kelly will lead the Pledge of Allegiance for those who say it.
Father, thank you for your goodness to each and every one of us. And Lord, as we do walk this path of life here, and we search for truth and understanding in so many of the issues that we face today, we're a flawed people, but you're not. So we just ask for your guidance, your leadership, and we ask that you would direct us. We ask that you would also anoint our speaker today to be able to convey the information that we need to know so we would understand that. And we ask that all that we do be done to your glory and your honor. In Jesus' name, and thank you for the food. Amen.
Attention to color. Hand salute. Pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, everybody have a seat. Make yourself comfortable. We got to make a few announcements here. I want to next talk about the Oklahoma City Council race. There is a runoff in Ward 4 between Todd Stone and a Mr. Morissette, who used to be in the legislature. I forgot to write down his lifetime index score. Does anybody know it off the top of your head? It was officially pretty low percent, wasn't it? Okay. So Todd Stone dropped by our meeting. He's in that runoff. Mr. Stone, come on up. 42 for his opponent on the conservative index. I'm just going to give him 60 seconds to talk about his campaign and the runoff, and then I have the other microphone if you want to ask him a question while he's here before he goes back to knock doors.
Thank you. I'm just going to take a couple of minutes. I've had the privilege of meeting a lot of you. If you don't know about me, my name's Todd Stone. I'm in the runoff for the Oklahoma City Council, Ward 4 position. Ward 4, although it starts over at Western, Southwestern Avenue, basically covers southeast Oklahoma City. So one thing I would ask is that if you know anyone in that ward and you're so inclined, we really need to get the vote out. So my name's Todd Stone. I'm a Christian. I'm a husband. I'm a father. I'm a grandfather, I'm a veteran, and I'm a Republican, and I'm running for Oklahoma City Council, Ward 4. My opponent is Richard Morissette, and he likes to do things like put flyers out the day before the election. Of course, this only goes to the Republicans, but if you can't read it, it's a voter alert saying, hey, what do you know about liberal Todd Stone, and shows a nice cartoon picture of me with my head on it saying, hey, I'm Todd Stone. I went to Cal Berkeley. And that's true. I did go to Cal Berkeley. My work about 20 years ago sent me there for a two-day seminar on fiber optics networks. I don't think I even saw any hippies or anything while I was there. I must have missed out. But these are the kind of attacks, you know, that we're facing. But we feel good about the runoff. We feel like we have the facts on our side. And he can run around doing stuff like this, but he can't run away from his record, which is what we're going to be exposing in this runoff. So,
anybody have any questions for Todd while he's here? What part of OKC?
It starts at Western, but basically it is southeast Oklahoma City. Yep, and Pete's retiring.
All right, Stefan, you got a question?
How do you stand on that convention hotel center that they want taxpayers to pay for?
I'm a little torn on that. Now, the only reason I'll tell you is why. The convention center, the new convention center, right or wrong, is already approved and funded. What I really want to do, though, is look at on the hotel that would be adjoining it. I really want to see what the facts and figures are in terms of return on investment of it. I can tell you this. They just voted the other day for another trolley car down there, which I still don't understand that.
Okay, Todd, I have a question. If we knew for a fact and we could prove that the hotel was going to make $1.3 million per year for the city, would you be in favor of it?
$1.3 million in favor of the city. What is the city's payout going to be on the at the onset? That's going to be the question.
No, that's free and clear profit. We know it's going to make money. So should we do the hotel or not?
I think you do. If it's going to make money for the city, I think you do. But I think you really have to look at how that's structured, because I have some issues there where you start combining city needs and city money along with the monies that would be inclined in private business.
Well, see, that's the problem. Even if we knew it was going to make money, it's going to be competing with private owners of businesses, and that's morally wrong to use everyone's money to compete with them, with their own money.
So
there's a moral problem. Even if it was going to make $5 million a year, it's not a proper function of city government. Take out the trash. Don't build hotels.
I don't disagree with you there at all.
Okay, so let me ask the question again. Okay. If we knew that the hotel was going to make $8.9 million a year, should the city build the hotel?
And let me ask you this question. If the city is building this convention center and it's doomed to failure, is that okay?
No, no matter what, cut the losses. It's not a proper function of government. Kiss it goodbye. Turn it over to someone else and walk away. Just because we pump a bunch of money into something is not an excuse to continue to do that when it's an improper function of government. Just cut the losses and walk away. We don't all keep hemorrhaging out in our own home when the budget doesn't balance. We stop doing it.
I agree.
So, all right. Thanks for your time. Anything else you want to say?
No, just if you know someone that lives in Ward 4, then I would really appreciate the support, and if you could convince them to get out and vote.
Thank you very much, Todd.
I do need money. I do need money. And if anyone would like to, I can leave some envelopes over here if anyone would like to donate. I can tell you, and I'm sorry I'm running over my 60 seconds, but...
You started early.
Good. I can tell you that in order to make the runoff, we started out with a 25-point disadvantage just based off name recognition. And besides that, we were outspent, I think, about 5-1. So we felt pretty good being able to make the runoff, and we feel really good moving forward from that. So I will leave some donation envelopes up here as I leave.
Very good.
And thank you for your time.
All right. Thank you, Todd Stone. Going to be examining a number of Senator Yun's bills, and here to do that is Amanda Teagarden, a longtime grassroots activist, a liberty fighter, one of us, a true friend in this battle for liberty at every turn. She just ran for the Senate in Oklahoma, Tulsa area, and lost by just under 200 votes. That's how close it was. But here to share with us today some of Senator Yin's authoritarian bills, please help me welcome Amanda Teagarden.
That number always bugs me of how close it was, but I didn't play football, so I didn't win. Okay. Thank you very much for having me again, John and Charlie. It's always good to see you. Thank you very much to OAKPAC also for all your support over the years. I consider myself very blessed. This has already been an interesting meeting because I was telling John when I was young, my dad was a member of the Jehovah's Witnesses for about 10 years. Our family participated in that through my dad, and then he started asking questions about the Watchtower Society and started doing his own research, and pretty soon he's like, okay, we're out of there. But I wasn't raised saying the Pledge of Allegiance in school, and that was in California. And so the teacher would go down the hall, down the rows there, as you're in elementary school, put your hand on your heart. And I always said, Dad, what are you supposed to do? And she goes, just put your hand down. So when she walked by, I put my hand down, and I always felt pretty self-conscious. We also didn't do the birthdays and the Christmas. What I'm going to tell you as a born-again Christian is that I think that training also helped me not to go along, because you survive all of those kinds of things. You come to a realization of where deception is, but you also know not to bow down to authority. So, yay, Dad. Okay. Unless it's your dad. Okay. All right. We've got... I don't know Senator Irvin Yen personally, and I don't have anything to say about him personally. My experience with him is a sum total of looking at his legislation in preparation for the citizen involvement training class that I did in Tulsa before session started. That caused me to look at current Senate bills that were introduced, and I focused on the Senate, and today I'm focusing on the Senate as well. It's considered the upper chamber. Statistically, more bills come out of the Senate side and actually come become law than on the House side. The Senate, I looked at Senator Yen's bills, and he had introduced 18 bills, and I'd already been alerted to his reputation because of some other issues that had come up. So I started looking at his bills, and I called John, and I said, listen, he's got 18 bills. There's not one anybody could support, really. And some of the bills that he's introduced actually are very unnecessary in addition to, if you just had to guess what his political leanings were, would be statist. And that's not knowing him personally whatsoever. If you just look at the flavor of the legislation he's introduced, you get an idea of his character or his political leanings. He should not be a Republican. All right, I've given you a handout, and this is a reiteration of what we discussed during the citizen involvement training class. And I teach people how to read legislation, how to contact their legislators, and how to do original research to some degree so you can help yourself versus being dependent. The first bill on your list, and these are pretty much in numerical order, Senate Bill 83, and this club has discussed the vaccine bill. It was originally intended to stop parental choice in that it wouldn't allow parents to opt out or exempt their children for religious or moral reasons and only allow for a medical exemption on vaccines. There's a lot of assumptions on this bill. For anybody that would be in support of it is to assume that vaccines are anywhere near they were when you and I were kids. They're not. The ingredients come from foreign countries. There's an enormous amount of chemicals in these vaccines. And I was thinking, you know, lately we've been talking to the midwives and thinking about the whole process. As a woman, when you're pregnant, what's the first thing you do is you stop drinking coffee and stop, you eliminate the caffeine and you can't take aspirin. Right? So here's the irony of ironies. You do everything you can to protect the baby, and you give birth, and then the doctors inject chemicals into them. After you've gone through all the process of doing the best you can to protect the infant, but it's okay if the state or some regulatory authority says, now we can inject aluminum, but not caffeine or aspirin. It doesn't make sense. Senate Bill 83 did pass out of committee after it was severely amended. It was amended to make it worse, which you mentioned in one of your other meetings. And how is it worse? Because now they've required that the legislators, that a parent who wants to exempt their child from a vaccine has to sit down and listen to a video that's produced by the State Department of Health. Right? And then they have to get it notarized that they actually viewed the movie, the video, and that they are still going to exempt themselves. You've had a lot of good discussion about why this is wrong. It does grow government, which, as a Republican, you shouldn't be for that. And the other thing is, it now creates an unfunded mandate. There is no dollars at the health care authority, or we're supposed to start adding dollars to produce a video and put it on a website and to allow somebody to monitor this. And then you've added another burden here. So even on the idea of growing government, it's wrong because it does grow government, and also creating an unfunded mandate. Even if you weren't on understanding what's wrong with the lack of exemptions for chemical injection into your children, you should look at it from a perspective of, we can't afford to do this as a state. So it was passed on the 27th and is now on general order as amended. It is asking everybody to still contact their senators and vote no on Senate Bill 83. Now, we have the votes on it, and you have several that voted no. You had Senator David, which surprised me that she did that. She voted no. Senator A.J. Griffin, Adam Pugh, and Frank Simpson all voted no. Senator Floyd, Yeck, McCourtney, Pittman, Rader, Standridge, and Yen voted yes. Rader is my senator. Right. I emailed my senator and said I was disappointed in his vote, and I talked to him about it beforehand. And I said, you know, the committee substitute did little to improve the bill. To the contrary, the substitute language results in the growth of government and creates an unfunded mandate, neither of which are justifiable, especially given Oklahoma's current economic situation. Republicans are supposed to be the party of limited government. Senate Bill 83 should have been an automatic no from the onset. He responds, Amanda, thanks for writing. It is unfortunate you read Senate Bill 83 with such understanding. Senate Bill 83, parental rights intact, as well as providing a way for education of the subject. Many have forgotten the immune, compromised child who has no choice. I hope we did enough for him or her. So, for his perspective, you're wrong, because they did something to protect the immune, compromised child. If you talk to anybody that's in that movement, that will tell you now you've exposed the immune-compromised child, more people being vaccinated who's then shed the thing that they are immune against. So all the senators, it's my understanding, have been provided a copy of the movie Vaxxed. The idea is to make sure that they view it and still justify their vote, but it should be a no vote on Senate Bill 83. Senate Bill 119, if we want to look at that one, is this is a simple little three-page bill by Senator Yen, and it's just a 500% increase in the seatbelt. If you don't have your seatbelt on and they catch you, it's a $20 fine. He increases it 500% to $100. And it's okay if they do that, though, because then it goes to some Department of Public Safety fund, and that's all good, right? You think?
Is this the bill they named after Charlie?
It doesn't. It's a revenue generator, is what it is. And so this is how the Republicans are looking to recover funds, is by increasing fees. This is a 500% increase. This one was assigned to the appropriations of public safety. It has not gone anywhere, and they were past the deadline, so that bill's not going to go anywhere. However, every bill that's not been killed in a committee is good for 2 years, so it could still be brought up. And the Senate has special rules, which we learned the hard way, is that language that you think is dead can be brought back by being added to a bill somewhere in the process or even in the last week. Senate rules are different than House rules, so you're actually going to have to watch that language the entire time. The next bill is, I want to talk to, go to the bottom of the page where it says House Bill 1922. In a weird way, I believe that this is House Bill 1922, which is by Representative Kennedy in the House. Representative Kevin Calvey voted no. He was the only no vote in this committee, and he brought it to a couple of people's attention. And what it does is add the word neglect in the evidence that a child can provide, and consider neglect versus child included in child abuse. If you look at this bill in the context of neglect and vaccine exemptions, neglect could be a criminal charge. Now, there's an organization, the Oklahoma Justice Center, is opposed to this bill because of the hearsay reasons, for their reasons. But I think that this is, when Senator Yen was talking about he's got a few tricks up his sleeve, everybody is focused on the Senate side and the Senate bill and one bill. There's lots of ways to achieve the same objective, which is to criminalize vaccine exemption as neglect, which other states have done. If you do a search on neglect and vaccine exemptions, you're going to start seeing where some states have actually caused that to be a criminal charge against parents because they didn't seek health care, and that's considered neglect. So I would say no. House Bill 1922 did pass with Kevin Calvey's no vote being the only no vote, and it is now something that you have to watch as well. So defining vaccine refusal as child neglect is an article I have. If anybody's interested, I can show it to you. And I have the definition of neglect in the Oklahoma statutes as well. All right, next bill, we're going to go back up to Senate Bill 121. This one is not by Rader. This is by, this one is by Dave Rader, Senator from Tulsa. And this one I have nicknamed the cops and credit cards. Let me just ask you this. All right. There's a warrant out for your arrest because you've got a misdemeanor crime. You've been convicted of a misdemeanor or any other offense, which I believe that would be called felonies, and any other offense, and you owe a fine. What does this remind you of? The cop pulls you over and said, I can take you to jail or you can pay me.
Third world country.
I used to live outside of Chicago. It kind of sounds like Chicago is too. You pay the cops for two reasons, extortion or protection. So I call this cops and credit cards. Apparently a former law enforcement official in some capacity has requested this bill, and the author of the bill is defending it, is saying it just gives the policeman, the law officer, a third choice. He can stop somebody, he can arrest them, or he can let them go. This just gives him a third choice and says we can take your payment. Just so I asked him, I said, what could go wrong with this? He said, I said, so you're supposed to hand over your credit card to the policeman? And he said, no, it's private. You get an iPad. And the cop hands the perpetrator an iPad, and the iPad, the perpetrator inputs his own credit card and a debit card information, because all perps have that, right? Right? And that keeps their privacy on their bank, because see, now you're giving the police access to your bank account if it's a charge card or a debit card. Somebody pointed out, I talked to an attorney about this, and he said a lot of people who have been convicted of misdemeanors and other offenses aren't driving around with credit cards and debit cards. They're operating on cash. So you can't take cash. So I asked Rader, I said, where did the iPads come from? Apparently he had asked no questions on how this works, and he said they're free. And I said, so where did they come from? No, they're just there. They're provided. And I said, so I'm thinking, okay, this is an ongoing expense for an IT. And I said, what if the guy drives off with the iPad? He said, well, you know, I guess they'll just have to go get him. And I said, just like, do you not even ask any kind of questions about how this would work? And I said, and let alone, the idea of this country was the separation of powers and three sets separation of the branches of government. Public safety is under what branch of the government, OPEC? Executive, come on. Executive, because the Department of Public Safety secretary is appointed by the governor. So that's executive branch, all right? So you got law enforcement is there. What about the judicial system? That's the courts, right? Those are criminal charges in the court systems. That's another branch of government, and then you have the legislature. If the cops become the bill collectors for the courts, you've now blurred the line between the courts, which is the judicial, and the executive branch. That was totally lost on him. Yes?
Yeah, man, you mentioned the idea of the policemen have two options in this dialogue. They could either arrest them or they could let them go. What about the third option and give them a ticket? Isn't that still valid anymore?
How about doing their job? Is there an officer of the court acting in that capacity? If there's a warrant for arrest, they're supposed to take them in. That's their job.
Amanda, as one who has to pay liberty tax for not wearing a seatbelt about twice a year.
We're going to fight that bill, Charlie.
Okay, appreciate that. When I get stopped and he writes a ticket, he hands me the ticket to sign, and it makes it very clear the signature is not an admission of guilt. Okay? Now, the options are now, if I refuse to sign it, then he can take me in. But if I sign it, then I am agreeing that I've received this ticket, I have a court date, and such as that. But my signature is not an admission of guilt. Now, I will say this. I'm going to pay that ticket, and it would save me time if I just paid it right then and there.
This is if you've been convicted, so it's not at the time of the stop.
Well, I know, but I mean, I'm going to admit my guilt, and I'm actually, I don't admit guilt. I sign it as nulla contender and pay my fine.
At the court?
Well, I mail it in.
Or you can mail it in.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Yeah, I definitely don't want to have to go to court. You know,
I'm just amazed. Everybody thinks when they talk about paying cops and credit cards for misdemeanor crimes, people's minds automatically go to traffic stops. Why? We just passed a question 780 and 781. We expanded what is a misdemeanor to include criminal charges for drugs, and theft. Those are now misdemeanors. It's not just traffic violations. This is going to be anything that's now a misdemeanor, which in our state has now been expanded to include charges that were crimes against people. That's who your audience is. That's who's going to be being asked to pay this. So it's not just your, you know, Joe Blow with the traffic tickets. That could be part of it. But if there's a warrant out for not paying court costs or your misdemeanor fees, it's now a whole bunch of other people. So this is why one bad idea can lead to another bad idea, and you don't opt for efficiency when efficiency just means we're regressing to the blending and blurring the lines between all the branches of government. Liberty comes when there's separation and a great deal of inefficiency. A policeman can deprive you of your liberty. He can legally shoot you. He can arrest you. He can do a lot of things. And I have friends who are law enforcement. But you shouldn't lose sight of the issue is that is the person with the gun who can deprive you of your liberty, and you should not be paying him. Just on a practical perspective, you shouldn't be doing that. And I think it's an unfair burden on law enforcement as well, as now you're a bill collector. What do you think? That's a revenue generation act. The other one is an expense. If there's a short fund, where do you think the emphasis is going to be? It's going to be on go out and collect some more bills. Apparently, this is Highway Safety Day because there were all kinds of state troopers between Tulsa and here. And I was really good. I didn't get a ticket because I saw them all. But they're all over the highways right now because it's revenue generation time. Yes.
I'm sorry.
Hey, Mike.
Hi. You're probably aware that when you get a traffic ticket, most of the cost of the ticket is court costs, not fines. For example, when you see a sign on the interstate, fines double in work zones.
Yes.
That means that your ticket goes from $177 to $192 because the fine's only $15. Do you think maybe that this, I don't know, but maybe this could be a good thing because now you're only going to pay the fine of $15 and you won't have to pay the $177 of court cost.
Here's the language, Senate Bill 121. This act applies only to the payment of a fine and or court costs associated with the conviction of a misdemeanor offense by a defendant or a judgment for fines and or court costs of a defendant convicted of any offense if a failure to pay warrant has been issued in the case. So I'm not looking for it to be easier for law enforcement to actually be the bill collector. And I've seen those electronic tickets because I got one $125 driving the speed limit in a work zone. And he asked me where I work, and I said, you got to be kidding. Anyway, why would you give policemen more authority and to tap into your financial records anyway, iPad or not? Why? You shouldn't be doing that. Protect what you've got. We've got very little left. All right. Senate Bill 121, efficiency aside, and paying that $15 court cost. Okay, the next one here is Senate Bill 295, one of my favorite bills by Senator Irvin Yen. This one is so easy to hate. Okay, this is called, I heard about this bill. I had actually pulled it and was including it in the citizen training class, but Senate Bill 295, I call it the demand and scan bill. He calls it his textilizer bill. Textilizer is a play on the word breathalyzer. So he likens texting and using your cell phone while you're driving to be drunk. He compares that in the justification, the rationale of the bill. He says this is like drunk driving. We already have distracted driving. All right. So now he's saying that this is an impairment. You're impaired. And so this is a textilizer. And what it is allows, it doesn't go into detail except that it allows for the law enforcement, the first officer that arrives on the scene of an accident or a traffic incident, is to demand the cell phones of those who are there, whose cars are involved. And if you can refuse, but you're going to end up in court and you're going to lose your license. So you really have to turn over your phone, and they're going to attach it. This is a test, field testing of an electronic device that the phone gets attached to, that checks to see if the phone was in use at the time or about the time or before the accident. So you can already begin to see the wheels are turning. It's like, how do you know the car, the phone call, or your phone being on in your car had anything to do with the accident? It could have been somebody nodded off. It could have been the jelly donut somebody was reaching for. It could have been a bug in the car, et cetera. Doesn't matter what the cause of the bill of the accident is. The phones are going to be turned over. And to determine if they were on at the time of or about the time of the accident. How do you know when the accident was? And as somebody's pointed out, you can be receiving a text message. It doesn't mean that you answered it. Your phone could have been ringing at the time, and it doesn't mean that you answered it. I did some research. There's one or two companies that make this. One is called Cellebrite, which is an Israeli-based tech firm that does this to counteract terrorism. And it's called a UFED, U-F-E-D, Universal Forensic Extraction Device. And it extracts all the information. It bypasses all your security codes and the locks on your phone, regardless of what model phone you've got. Remember a few years back, there was the one, somebody had an iPhone that the security code was on it, and the man was accused of terrorism, and he wouldn't get over his...
Bakersfield.
Yes, he wasn't going to give over his access code, and so they were going after Apple to see if they would give them the code to break it in. They wouldn't. This overrides that, so it can't extract it. If you read the brochure on this UFED, it actually can extract your contacts, your text messages, your deleted text messages, and photos and games or whatever else. Now, he says in his bill that it's not going to do that, but the product brochure that goes for these UFEDs says that's exactly what it does. But you can trust the government. We're only going to use part of it, right? The company, if you just look at it for a product competition, this guy's going to say, well, this, let's say it's Cellebrite. Well, our product, we'll just make sure we'll dumb it down so it only checks to see if the phone was on. His competitor's going to say, I've got a better model. We're going to extract everything because eventually you're going to need that information as well. This is really bad. He never talks about what company is going to get the contract. He never talks about the costs. He doesn't, anyway, so it's about field testing an electronic device to extract, to check if your cell phone was on at the time of the accident. It's wrong on a lot of levels. It's wrong on search and seizure. It's wrong on the assumption of the cause of the accident. And if you look at it as much in the context now that we have businesses who are operating, their small owners, small business owners, their entire business is on their phone. It could have proprietary information about their products, contacts about meetings or contracts coming up. We have mobile health information now, so you've got doctors and those people who are in the healthcare industry now sharing electronic health records. That could be on a phone. And so we've got HIPAA laws involved. This bill, Senate Bill 295, his textilizer bill, was assigned to public safety. I spent two visits to the Capitol going to the public safety committee meeting members to kill this bill and Raider's bill. To oppose it. Neither one of them got out of committee, but they're still alive because they could be brought up next year. But this bill and 121 both, I think, are very dangerous pieces of legislation that need to be stopped. Senate Bill 569. Is there anybody that has questions or thinks this is a good idea?
I'll just make the comment that if we have technology, it gets used. So just because they have a phone scanner for one purpose, they're going to be running up and down the highway. They can scan phones all around them on Interstate 44. They'll be within 50 yards of a dozen cars. They could scan every phone when this device is in somebody's hands. And when you have it, you use it.
For those who go back to 2007 know that OK Safe started because we fought the Trans-Texas Corridor. In order to fight that, I had to start reading about federal legislation dealing with our U.S. transportation system. What we have is something that's going to be the smart transportation system, where everything is your smart cars, sensors in the road, scanners above, and a lot of this technology was anticipated a long time ago. The technology is probably 20 years ahead of where the public knows that it is. The objective was the intelligent vehicle highway system objective was ultimately you could just sit a police car or anybody could sit there, and as cars go by, you have automatic access to any telecommunications in the car in real time. So you can pull up behind and somebody and follow, then you can find out if the car, if there's a phone conversation going on. So we're bypassing anything to do with the Fourth Amendment, and you're right. So keep your phone off for a lot of reasons, but it's not a good idea because we're going to an intelligent highway system. And intelligent and smart always has to do with technology. All right, Senate Bill. Yes.
What's it going to cost the state for these scanners?
Oh, I'm sure they'll be free to beginning.
Is that in the bill?
It is not. It's that the Department of Public Safety will have the Highway Patrol engage in field testing of an electronic scanning device.
Well, I'm sure if we ever pass it, the federal government will pay for it for us. As long as we use it in prescribed ways.
So it's free.
Question over here.
It's free. Okay. All right, Senate Bill 569. Anybody in here own a pawn shop or precious metal dealers, pawnbrokers? You know some? All right, I did too, so I called my friends who were in this business. I buy silver, you know, at Tulsa Gold and Silver. So you can buy, so you're in those. This bill, Senate Bill 569, also by Yen, is deals with pawnbrokers and precious metal dealers. And it seems like, oh, well, what's that got to do with? But those are small business owners. And this bill prohibits a pawnbroker from also having a precious metals dealer license. So you cannot have dual licensure. It also requires, if you go to a pawn shop, if you're delivering something that you're supposed to be taking this digital photo of. Now, if you go into the pawn shop and buy it, he's proposing you also take a digital photo of the buyer. So there goes your privacy as far as buying. So now the seller and the buyer are going to have a digital photo on sale. Plus, it goes into a lot of detail about what they can and cannot do with the precious metals, making it to be a long storage problem, long-term storage problem for items that were brought in that could have been sold for melting down purposes and repurposed, you know, whether it's a piece of silver that could be melted down for silver coins and sold in by the ounce. This prohibits them from doing that for a set period of time. I talked to my friend who was in this business. There's a pawnbroker association. They've been notified about this. This is a bad bill. It's anti-business. And it's more big government if you're looking at it. Why would you prohibit dual licensure and make it harder? So now we would have to have two businesses or a business next door to each other, but you can't have dual licensure. It is crazy. It's not a good idea, but that's another Senate bill. Senate Bill 569 by Yen. Yes.
You know, I can almost see a reason behind the other bills. Even though I disagree with them, I see a reason. What is the logic behind this one at all? Where is the reasoning?
I have no idea what prompted this, except this is just kind of out there. Pawn shops can also be an alternative method of getting a loan that's not through a bank.
Like payday loan?
If you just look at it, it's maybe one of those alternative financial systems. This makes them more like banks, where you have to take photo ID, you get the eye color, the driver's license. This is of the buyer as well. So your options for private enterprise are being limited because you can't go someplace, make a private deal, and not have your photo taken. So it's very suspect. I don't see any reason for it except to hinder business. And it's... That bill was assigned to business, commerce, and tourism, and it did not get out of committee, but it's still active. It's still active. Do we like Senator Yen? This guy has just, like, not very many good ideas. Okay, Senate Bill 745 is medical marijuana with an H, and this one actually did pass. Senate Bill 745. Oh, it's not on your list. I just brought it because it's one of his that did pass. All right, so the federal involvement in medical marijuana did pass. Just give you an extra, this is his one bill that actually got out of committee, second bill. What this does is involve multiple agencies for the prescribing of medical marijuana. I think one of the most interesting things about this bill is spelling marijuana with an H instead of a J. So I did a little bit of research last night on the difference in spelling, because usually words have meaning, and apparently H is the more formal legal definition of marijuana, M-A-R-I-H-U-A-N-A, versus the J, which is the street language. All right, he's got several pages of new law here. But I'm going to tell you, this is not a small government bill. It's a big government bill. It involves the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, the U.S. Department of Drug Enforcement, U.S. DEA, the Oklahoma State Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs, the National Control on another one on dangerous drugs, University Med Centers, which is a state-based education, and the Oklahoma State Board of Regents get to decide the rules. Okay. That one did get out of committee. Yek, Simpson, and Standridge voted no. Rader and Yen voted yes, because it was his bill. All right, the next bill, our prior guest, Crystal, did a great job already talking about it, which is Senate Bill 747, which was one of the two bills targeting 714 and 747 were the two Yen bills targeting midwives. And Crystal already talked about it. 747 failed in committee. 714 is still active and could be heard next year. I had my second child, VBAC. It was a whole lot easier than the first child. My daughter was born cesarean, and after listening to all the consequences like that, it's like, oh, this is great. But successful VBAC for my son, and I highly recommend that versus, because the recovery time's a whole lot easier. And that's it. 714 is assigned to Health and Human Services, could be brought up next year. Have any questions on these bills?
I was just going to say, with the VBAC situation,
yes.
Doesn't it make a lot of difference what the reason was for the first cesarean?
It could.
I mean, if it was a breach delivery and they had to do it, that's one thing. But if there was other reasons for it, then that may not be the situation.
I was talking to Crystal beforehand, and this is mostly of interest to ladies here, is that sometimes the doctors have a schedule that they're trying to maintain, and so they'll schedule the birth on a day that's convenient for them and take the child by cesarean versus the natural delivery date of the baby. So there's a lot of reasons that cesareans are taking place. It's not necessarily because there was something dramatically wrong with the baby. It's a lot healthier, I think. The option to have cesarean, I think, is a life-saving option, but it shouldn't be number one.
Well, it's never a good idea to open the body and let oxygen touch your internal organs that aren't designed to deal with oxygen.
And they strap your arms down.
Right. Okay, this will be our last comment right here.
There's a big fight among the midwives because RNs are under the jurisdiction of the medical licensing board. The certified ones are not, and that's been going on. This is a way to monopoly game to get them out of the business.
Yeah, because midwives are just hurting people all over the place, right?
All right. Hey, everybody, thank Amanda for being here today and for her research.
Thank you very much.
Nope, it's always on, just like me. Okay, hey, you took my notes. Next week, we have Charlie Meadows is going to MC the meeting next week, and our guest speakers will be Travis Dunlap, Scott McEachin, and Joe Newhouse. Senator Joe Newhouse, Representative Scott McEachin are freshmen, and Travis Dunlap is just in his second year, and he will also be receiving awards from us. They'll be talking about what their expectations were before they got there and how Now that they're there, maybe those have changed, and also bills that they're working on. That's next week. So now I'm going to ask Travis Votaw, if you would step up here, lead us in closing prayer, and then we'll see you all next week.
Hey, let's pray. Following this time of conflicting political information, we ask you to give us the discernment to know the truth as we hear these things, to give us a resolve to act on this truth, to protect us, save us, in Jesus' name. Amen.